this looks like it's, we're getting to that time of year where we're doing the normal type of things before we get up to the holidays. And one of the new normal things we're going to talk about is the owls. So Linda wants to talk about the owls, which have been resurrected after a couple of years. So.
You know, they could do that in Florida. And, but river, and that was by far our favorite restaurant that we ate at while we were there. So good, we ate there twice, and had different stuff both times, and it was still the best. So Virginia was right, and people were so friendly. And we're going to sing a song right now that talks about the family that we hope we are. And we're going to sing it through once, and then we're going to give you a chance to greet everybody, and then we'll sing it again. Are you ready? Here we go. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood. Join hands with Jesus as we travel this sod. For I'm part of the family, the family of God. Turn around and shake hands with somebody. Let them know you're glad to see them.
Sweetest name on earth.
Start with Operation Vista Child, then I'll go back and talk about hunger. So go ahead and go to the first slide, Anna. Operation Christmas Child is just about upon us. If you got the one call and the text that says that the prayer sheet, if you hadn't picked that up, there's some out here in the foyer. You pick up that every day and pray for the a different aspect of Operation Christmas Child in that. Our church packing party is on November 12th, and you probably thought, well, that sounds kind of familiar. Well, that's the day we're going to have Thanksgiving meal here, too. So it's going to be a kind of a logistics thing that we're going to have to do is we'll do church and the meal, and then we're going to pack boxes. The church's goal is 200 boxes, and I know Sarah, and I know it's going to be more than that. She always has more than that. So we'll be doing that after the meal on the 12th. So also there are sign-ups out in the foyer for the drop-off center. When I talked to Sarah last time, not a lot of people signed up, but we got a lot of times that need to be covered. So if you would stop by there, look through it, see if you got a good slot, go ahead and sign up so that we can man the drop-off center for Operation Christmas Child. I think that remember it's the week of the 13th through the 19th. Sarah, is there anything else you think we need to bring up and tell people? I know you don't want to talk, but...
they invite their friends to any of it. Yeah. It's a good time for everybody.
Yeah, so on the 12th, you know, when we're doing our Thanksgiving meal, it's a good time to invite people to church and say, oh, by the way, we're going to pack boxes too. So, anyway, that, make sure you mark that down. Go ahead and go. Yep.
I have a question.
Always, if you see something when you're out and shopping, pick it up, because I mean it's not like it's going to end up going to waste. So it'll get in a box. Or the other things is we're sending, actually Robert Sherrier sent a lot of boxes, big boxes, not shoe boxes, to the Philippines. We're getting things ready and shipping them out to them so that they can do another one of those evangelistic clinics that they did in the past. And hopefully we can have them ready to go by the end of the year, so I'm going to do that as well. Okay, the update on Honduras, as you saw on the slides and that of some of the pictures and that from it, one of the other things that Linda had brought up was questioning about some of the places we've been. So what I do is usually when I come home is I have a big map of Honduras. I stick a map pin in it and where we were, and I put that map back there on the table. If you want to look at that, you can kind of see some of the places that we've been in the last 12 years of going, and a number of people here have gone with us as well. Yeah, Ray was standing back there with me, and we were looking at that, and I was showing them, pointing out the places that when they went with us last summer, where it was. Anyway, so the statistics, we saw over 1,000 people, which it didn't seem like it, but it was 1,000 people, and it was over 300 families. The doctors, I thought it was a little bit low number for the doctor, but it's usually every person sees the doctor, but they had listed it in our statistics, 597. We gave out 379 pairs of glasses, and every one of those pairs of glasses went out with an eyeglass case. So, this thanks a lot for the ladies that, in the church here that have made those eyeglass cases. And well, when you tell somebody that somebody here made an eyeglass case for them, it really, you should see how they light up, and it's special to them that somebody thought to make them an eyeglass case. They were a little low on the dentist, too. The place we were at, the people had better dental health than I thought. They only pulled 60 teeth. Gave out 3 hearing aids and gave out 1,961 prescriptions. But the key is, adult salvations were 132 and 88 children accepted Christ. As always, we invite anybody that wants to go, if you have an inkling that the Lord is calling you to go out on a short-term mission trip, come see me or Angie. We get you signed up and get you to go. And like we talked about in our Sunday school class, when the priest with the Ark of the Covenant stepped in the Jordan River when they were getting ready to go across, that took a lot of faith to step out there. That's the kind of faith something might take for you to go the first time, but after you're gone, I think you'll see the benefits. And there's a number of people, particularly Mike, Kathy, and Taylor, and Ray, can tell you, if you don't want to believe Angie and I, but that they can tell you the blessings from going. Thank you.
We're going to dismiss our kids right now to go to Kids Club, and we'd like the rest of you to stand for one more song. And God is good. He's always good. He's good all the time. And as Kathy leads us in the song, let's just praise the Lord together on this great song.
All my life you have been so good.
you so much. This coming Saturday, be much in prayer for Robert Redmond. He has been given a special distinct honor to be a part of an honor flight, and he'll leave early Saturday morning, fly to Washington, D.C. for a bunch of wonderful opportunities. A lot of this is commemorating his 30-plus years in the military. And then he will fly back that evening. And actually, at about 8:30 to 8:45 at the Evansville Airport, there will be a parade that's welcoming home the soldiers who have been invited, the veterans who have been invited to be a part of that honor flight. If you would like to go to that, it is open to the public, just to welcome those who have served our country so faithfully. So it's a special honor to Robert, and it's also a special honor to all of those who will be joining him on that flight. Hey, I know that it's past the time that I usually begin my message, but we planned it this way. Today was Missions Sunday, and I'm going to go as far as I can go, but I'm not going to rush today, so you don't have to listen fast, okay? I'm going to take my time, and I'm going to stop. We are still in a sermon series on the book of Job. I'm about halfway through. Let me remind you just a little bit. I don't mean to be repetitious, but I want you to remember the situation. Job, in this phase of our message, he is in the middle of his trouble. And he had already lost all of his possessions. His 10 kids have been killed in a storm. And he had a serious skin disease to where he's covered by boils. His wife finally loses her patience, and she says, "Job, why don't you just curse God and die?" Now, that brings us, even though it's not part of our text today, that brings us to Job chapter 2, verse 10. And Job said this to his wife. He said, "Shall we accept good from God but not trouble?" So if we're willing to accept all of God's blessings, shouldn't we be willing to accept trouble? Shouldn't we be willing to say, you know what, this trouble is just a part of life? Well, hey, I've got a story for you. And you know, Kathy and I, our vacation was as good as it ever was. It was a good vacation from beginning to end. But there were things in the middle of it that we wish we hadn't experienced. Where our resort was, where we stayed, it was just within 100 yards or so of just some intense poverty. And we saw people sleeping on the streets. And so there was some sadness there, and so there were some things along the way that we wish we hadn't have had to have seen. But that's the way life is sometimes. On our way home, we were kind of ready to get home. We weren't ready to leave, but you know, there's one of those things that whenever you get in the car and head back, we were all the way down in Daytona, Florida, so we had a long drive coming home, and we got this bright idea that we're going to drive through the night and make it all in one trip. And the truth is, we were both so rested up, it sounded like a good idea. We were pretty well awake. And we committed to at least get to the other side of Atlanta so that we wouldn't have to face any traffic jams on the way home. We went through Atlanta sometime after midnight, and we get in the far northern suburbs of Atlanta, and nature calls. And so I had to take an exit, and the sign said, you know, to the right, that there was a convenience store that I could go to. And so I'm headed down the road, and I'm thinking, man, it's a long way to this convenience store. one that nature was calling. So I was kind of in a rush to get there. And finally came to this spot, and you're looking around, and it's just not the best part of the city. Have you ever been there? Did I tell you it was well after midnight? And so there we were. We weren't in the best part of the city. And I went to turn in, and I turned in at the spot you were supposed to turn out, which you'd have thought would have been okay. But the speed bump that I hit busted a tire in the middle of the night. Well, the thing I hadn't told you about was on the trip, I tried to shove the hatchback closed on our SUV and pinched some stuff in it, and as a result, I couldn't get my hatchback to open or close. So we had to load everything from the back seat. And it had just finished raining, everything was wet, so to get to the tire, we had to unload everything from the back seat, including to go all the way down into that tire well and get the little donut out. I get the donut out, and it doesn't have enough air in it. So it's just one of those nights. But you know what? I wasn't like Job's wife. I never thought, why don't you just curse God and die? You know? I never thought that. It was never a part of my mind because it's not a part of my DNA. Was I frustrated? You better believe it. Was I aggravated? You better believe it. I was a little bit aggravated at myself. Anyway, it was just a sign that we had driven too far. It was just a sign that I was a lot more tired than I wanted to admit. But I got that donut on, and have you ever seen the jacks that they put with cars now? I mean, this jack that's this size is supposed to hold up a 1,500-pound car. And then they give you little tools that don't really fit it. You scratch your knuckles every time you turn it, but finally I get it up. Change the tire and get it down, and I'm trying to drive the vehicle over to where the air is so I can air that donut up. And so we get it aired up, and we're about to leave. You know, talk about timing. And a AAA driver pulls in to go get him a soft drink at the convenience store. Working the night shift, and my wife, she is so friendly, she likes talking to everybody, and she wanted to talk to him, make sure we were all right. So she does. Friendliest guy, And so we are both talking to him now, and I know that I can't drive far. And he says to Kathy, he says, well, you know there's a 24-hour tire shop not 2 miles from here. And I thought, well, Kathy thought, how would we know? We're from Indiana. But in my mind, I'm thinking, who ever heard of a 24-hour tire shop? So he pulls up the address online, shows us, and I'm looking at the picture, and I thought, man, I'm excited about going to this place. So we drive even further into the area to where we don't want to be. And whenever we pull into this place, the lot is well lit. And the only thing that gave the indication was that this place was even open was there was a 4-letter neon light that said open, and it was flashing. But other than that, it looked like the loneliest place you'd ever be in the city. And whenever we pulled in, I walk up to the door, the guy comes up, and he reaches in his pocket for his keys because he's locked himself in. And before he unlocks the door, he goes, then he unlocks the door and he says, "Can I help you?" And so I look at him and I said, "Who ever heard of a 24-hour tire shop?" I thought it was funny. He looked at me and he said, "What do you need?" And so I told him, and he was this delightful man from Nigeria. And anyway, he came out and he helped Kathy and I. Now remember, whenever we changed the donut, we had to unload everything on wet ground, and then we had to put it back in with the tire, and had to set it on top of the tire so our stuff didn't get dirty. So now we're at his place. We got to unload everything again and get the tire out. And he says, "Yeah, I can fix this. I'll be back in a minute." And so I said, "How much do I owe you?" After he got done, he said, $15. I thought, $15? And this was a young man. I knew he needed the money. I gave him $40. And I said, "No, keep the change." Well, he was so happy, he came out and helped me load back up. And now, I just want you to know, I hope you've captured in the middle of this, in the middle of all the frustration, God was still present. And there were still bright spots to be had. I asked this guy, I said, "How long have you been in the States?" And he said, "About 5 years." And we began talking to him, and he was just honest with us. He says, "I'm here because I need money." He says, "There's not any money in Nigeria." He said, "But I miss home." And so we just kind of shared with him the goodness of God, how God had brought him into our lives at a time that we needed it. And we just shared those things on how God can touch our lives. But whenever we look at Job's story, he went through a whole lot in a matter of a few days. He went through so much more than we went through in those couple of hours. I'm quick to wonder, aren't you, how did Job do it? How did he go through all of that? And how did he maintain his integrity during his suffering? I sat next to a man at one of the dinners that we went to. It was one of the excursions that we paid extra for our trip. And the man I sat next to, a fly bothered him. And he blurted out an obscenity. He cursed his God. And we live in a day today that it is so common to curse God for simple, natural things. It is so common to lose our cool. We let the littlest thing bug us. No pun intended. But here was Job. And in the middle of one conflict after another, he doesn't give up. He maintains his integrity. How did he find the pathway of patience? How did he endure to the end of his trials? Now, I want to remind you that there were moments in there that Job wished that he had never been born. He said, "I wish I'd have never been born." So he was being honest. He was being human. He was saying, "If I'd never been born, I wouldn't feel this sorrow right now. I wouldn't feel the pain that I'm going through right now." But I want you to notice that even though he went through times that he wished things were not the way they were, he never lost his integrity, and he never lost the feeling in his heart that he felt for his God. Even though he wished other things for himself, he still trusted God. He acknowledged the truth that God was the only one who could sustain him. He understood the very nature of God. He knew that God was righteous. And throughout the entire book, the 42 chapters of the book of Job, he declares the righteousness that he found in his God, and he even maintained his innocence and his integrity. But it was because he understood the nature of God. How could we understand the nature of God? Several years ago, I was called at the last minute. I was called and asked if I could come to a youth camp and teach some teenagers. And so, within 24 hours' notice, I headed there to spend the week teaching teenagers. And whenever I got there, they handed me the books that I was supposed to be teaching. And I was going to get to teach high school students about the Trinity, about the very nature of God, about the idea that even if you get down to the very crux of the matter, about a subject that confuses adults, and I'm supposed to teach it to teenagers. So I'm thinking, what am I going to do? And there was a pastor friend of mine, his name was Scott, and he got called for the same purpose. Some others had canceled at the last minute, and so we sat down together with books that we had just seen, and we decided, as if we were college students cramming for a test, we decided we were going to work together. And we agreed that the material was way over the heads of these kids. So how are we going to use biblical terms to describe the Trinity to teenagers? Now, did you know that the book of Job talks about the Trinity? It really does. Matter of fact, we know that whenever Job said in Job 19, verse 25, he says, "I know that my Redeemer lives, and one day he will stand on this earth." Job was already envisioning a Savior who would live on the earth. And the Savior would be the Son of God. And so even Job understood all of that. Now, it's amazing to me that sometimes whenever people's pressures get their greatest, they are finally willing to look to God and reach out to Him. Many people find faith in God whenever pressures are the greatest. Now, it's also true that many abandon their faith in God in those times. Let's remember that in wartime, they said there are no atheists in foxholes. You have a way of finding God when the bullets are flying all around you in the time of war. But for us to gain a proper understanding of our God, we need to make every effort to search the Scriptures and see what the Bible says about our God. In Deuteronomy 6:4, the Bible says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord." So we have one God. In Deuteronomy 33, the Bible says the eternal God is our refuge. So He is our protection. He's the one we run to. But I want to point out to you the Scripture that my friend Scott and I came to. It is found in Mark chapter 12. It says, "The first of all the commandments is this," verse 29. "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord our God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, and that with all your strength." So, it comes from a quotation in the book of Deuteronomy. Jesus was saying these words, and it comes from the first commandment ever given to mankind. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. But in the New Testament, we find that the word strength was even added, and in a couple of places in the Old Testament as well. But we are to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, soul, and mind. My friend Scott and I, as we were cramming to teach that lesson to the kids on the Trinity, my friend Scott said, "You know, if we could figure out our composition, we would better know the composition of God." as he began saying that, that made sense. Because in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, the Bible says, let us make man in our own image. Now, our Bible was not written in English, but it was written in Hebrew. And the name for God in that passage of Scripture is Elohim. Now, what's interesting about Elohim, when it says, let us make man in our own image, Elohim is one of the names of God, but it is the only name of God that is plural. And it doesn't suggest three gods, but it suggests the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit all working together in harmony in that one Godhead. And so we hear the words in the very first chapter of the Bible, let us make God in our own image. Let us compose mankind. And let us make man like us. And you and I are made with flesh. We are made with a brain. And we are made with a spirit. So again, if you're following with me in your notes, whenever we understand our composition, because we were made in the image of God, we can better understand the composition of God. And so we are commanded to love the Lord our God with all of our heart. The heart of God is Jesus. The heart represents God the Son. The soul of God represents God, the Holy Spirit. And then the mind of God represents God the Father. In John chapter 1, beginning in verse 1, it says there, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was God, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Later on it says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That was Jesus. The Word was the plan that God had, the mind of God, whenever He made the plan to send His Son Jesus to earth to save our souls from sin. Now, there are just three quick points that I just want to share with you in this message. And I want to go back and look at Job just for a second. Job acknowledged God whenever Job felt insufficient. Job acknowledged God whenever he felt insufficient. I told you that sometimes Job wished he had never been born. In Job chapter 3, beginning in verse 1, notice what the scripture says. Job says, may the day perish on which I was born, and the night in which it was said a male child is conceived. May that day be darkness. May God above not seek it, nor the light shine upon it. May darkness and the shadow of death claim it. May a cloud settle upon it, and may the blackness of day terrify it. As for that night, may the darkness seize it, because it did not shut up the door of my mother's womb, nor hide sorrow from my eyes. Why is light given to him who is in misery, and life to the bitter of soul? Now, have you ever said, why was I even born? What's my purpose in life? Right now, that's what Job is saying. He's saying, I would have never experienced this pain had my mother never formed. Now, we read in other passages to where Job talks about his pain, and yet he knows that there is something bigger than life ahead waiting for him. But in the moment of his pain, he felt insufficient. Have you ever been there? Have you ever felt insufficient? What's my purpose? I can remember whenever Kathy's dad passed away. he passed away at even a more than terrible time as far as Kathy's mom was concerned. They were both taking care of my mother-in-law's mother. And grandmother required constant care. And whenever my father-in-law passed away, there my mother-in-law was shut in with her mother. And if that were not tough enough, sometime later, and then her mother did pass away as well, but a granddaughter moved in with her. A granddaughter who had a meth problem and had some unruly children. And I even remember, even though my mother-in-law was in God's Word every single day, there were times that she would say to us, I wish I knew what my purpose was now. I think it is safe to say, and Kathy and I pretty much agree, that in the remaining many years of her life, that my mother-in-law never fully realized her purpose. But that granddaughter she took in looked up to her grandmother more than any other person on earth. And that granddaughter is now a child of God, and her kids are in church. And so, even though my mother-in-law couldn't see the purpose in the moment, she remained faithful. She remained faithful. She remained faithful. Because there is something greater for us. God has prepared a wonderful place for us. So Job acknowledged God whenever he felt insufficient. Job also acknowledged God whenever he felt confused. In Job 6, Job said, "It is impossible to even weigh my misery and grief. They outweigh the sand along the beach." I guess I had to throw a beach thing in there since we went on vacation to the beach. Then Job says, that's why I've spoken these things without thinking first. If you ever just spoke up without thinking, you hadn't thought something through, well, that's the way Job was. He was confused. He goes on to say later on in chapter 6, he says, how I wish that God would answer my prayer and just do away with me. Then I would be comforted. Why would he be comforted? Because he knows heaven's waiting for him. I would be comforted knowing that in all my pain that I never disobeyed God. So I want you to notice in his confusion, Job was saying, God, I'm down so far, I'm afraid I'm going to give in pretty quick. I'm afraid I'm going to give up pretty quick. Have you ever been there to where you thought, I'm going to give up soon, I'm going to give in soon, I don't know where to turn next? Job also says in Job chapter 6, verse 12, he says, I'm not as strong as stone. I'm not as strong as bronze. I finally reached the end of my rope. So he's saying, God, if you don't answer soon, I don't know what I'm going to do. And this brings us to the third and final point. Job acknowledged God when living was difficult. He said in Job 7, he says, why is life so hard? You ever asked that? He said to God, why do we suffer? He said in verse 7 of chapter 7, he's saying, I beg you, God, don't forget. My life is just a breath and trouble lies ahead. Yeah, sometimes life is hard. And when it is, we suffer during those times. And sometimes we wonder if there's trouble around the next turn in the road. Trouble like that I experienced this week. times, troubling times, there is still someone who can sustain us. There is still someone there who can keep us going. In Isaiah 51 and 12, I close with this verse. God says to us, I, even I am He, the one who comforts you. So then He says, why should you ever be afraid? God says, I've got this. Your struggles, your suffering, all of that's temporary. God says, I've got this. Just trust me. Just hang on. Just endure. I'm going to make it right. I'm going to make it right. He's seen me through so many things. Some of them as simple as a flat tire in the middle of the night in the dangerous part of town. But I want to tell you, He's brought me through a lot greater than that. He's brought me through my heartaches. He's brought me through my trials. He's brought me through my temptations. He's brought me through my worst sorrows. He's been there every time I have needed. And so I can look to Him and say, Lord, whenever my righteousness has failed, I can trust in Yours. And Your grace will sustain me. If He did that for me, He'll do it for you. Let's pray. Father God, I ask that You be with our church family today. You know our needs far better than we. And dear God, if there is anyone that needs to come forward and pray about their needs, give them the courage to do so. Lord, I would consider it an honor to be able to pray with them about their needs. But dear God, we are praying together now as a church family. As they are hearing the voice of my prayers and uttering their needs to You in their hearts and in their minds, I pray that You would supply our needs here in this moment today. For I ask it in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Would you stand with us today as we sing?
Consider yourself. Michael's.